Sorry, we're starting late. Welcome, all of you. We're continuing with our series of Picasso conferences, and we have Dr. Deepak Anand with us, and he is a professor at École de Beaux-Arts at Normandy. He was born in New Delhi, and he studied in London at the Cohort Institute, a very large center for art history. He currently lives in France, and he was the curator of a large exhibition in Paris. Picasso, Matisse, Bouillard are some artists whose works he's worked on. He specializes in art history, and he's now going to make us with our speaker. Thank you very much, Dr. Deepak Anand.
Thank you, Nazan. I just want to say to you how delighted I am to be here. And I do want to thank Nazan and her team for inviting me today to speak on Picasso. I just want to say just two couple of introductory remarks, first of all about the title, because it says Picasso's avatars. Is it okay to sound? And the word avatar is obviously, comes from Sanskrit, but it's now entered sort of general English usage and French as well. And it does suggest transformation, metamorphosis, literally even transmigration. But I'm using it basically as the kinds of metamorphosis which Picasso's career is, a kind of sort of blueprint in a way. And it's the whole idea about how Picasso, during this long career of his, reinvents himself constantly. So the word avatar really has many resonances, but I think the easiest sort of resonance is probably of metamorphosis. And one other remark is that this talk reviews some of the most significant writings on Picasso, which is one way of entering this vast corpus. It's a sort of, in a way, a commentary on commentary, kind of meta-commentary on his oeuvre, which I hope will sort of suggest the very different ways of interpreting his paintings and his sculptures, sometimes in very contradictory ways. And I think one of the reasons why I thought I'd like to do this in this talk was to, it helps one to, highlight the multiple facets of Picasso's talents. Okay. Now, I start with an image which I'd like to sort of, I'd like you to see it in terms of a quotation from Picasso, a quotation which comes from, late in his life, in 1960, and it says, "If all the ways I have been along were marked on a map and joined up with a line, it might represent a minotaur." This is in 1960. Now, of course, the minotaur is this mythic animal, half human, half animal, mythic creature, really. And I think Picasso identified with this, with the minotaur, right throughout his life. But it's interesting that, he should bring up this image in 1960 to say that, I repeat, if all the ways I have been along were marked on a map and joined up with a line, it might represent a minotaur. Now, of course, there's no sort of drawing of what Picasso is saying in this metaphor, but I chose this painting, which is a painting from 1948, and it's called The Kitchen, just to sort of give you an idea of how one might figure Picasso's image of the Minotaur and the Labyrinth, because of course the two are inseparable. Because if you see over here, what you see, this is supposedly the kitchen, but it's basically a network of lines, which is very much like a maze or a labyrinth. And I just thought I'd show this as a way of imagining what the image of the Minotaur and the maze could look like. Okay. So it is that the waywardness of Picasso's career is immobilized for an instant, long enough for the image conjured by him to be cancelled by the very network of lines that configured it. For the space thus marked would, of course, be none other than that of the maze in which the Minotaur is imprisoned, a circuitousness inscribed within the very contour delineating the hybrid creature, so that even I want to go back to that, so that even a momentary framing of the monster would prove to be a sure way of felling it. And not only metaphorically, inasmuch as such ritual slaying is also one of the meanings of cadre, this is the French word for frame, which goes back to a term in bullfighting, which means that you immobilize the bull just prior to dealing it the fatal thrust. But returning to Picasso's image, the mythic being thus executed, in both senses of the word, is also the moment when the larger framework in which it is caught comes into view. The labyrinth itself, traced by the straying of the line that describes in its wake the shape assumed by the artist's career. And I just go back very quickly to this image of a kind of labyrinth here to suggest the kinds of loops and meanders of Picasso's career. That career had another 12 years to unfold before death closed the canon in 1973. So when Picasso's statement was recorded, he was, at the age of 79, delineating the unruliness of a lifetime's stylistic wanderlust by the very lineaments of the metaphoric as such, the composite being that is half animal and half human. Metamorphosis is the restless motor of Picasso's art, the avatars that issue from his prodigious and frequently prodigal impulse to displace, invert, substitute, alter, mutate, and mutilate a given set of conventions, that is to say, the grammar or codes of painting, or the grammar and codes of representation. The terms in which that impulse has come to be understood constitute by now a corpus of text that is as multifarious as the work itself. Inevitably, writing on Picasso or attempting an overview of his achievement is also an exercise in meta-commentary, a textual labyrinth in its own right, albeit one which lends itself to be signposted. The cue for such an historical and critical meander in the work might come from Picasso himself, in that the chiasmus between Minotaur and Maze that his image sets up implies, by extension, that any work or phase of works one might choose to dwell upon will be indissociable from the larger network in which it is caught. The playful conundrum, or whether it is the Minotaur that configures the maze, or, on the contrary, is configured by it, that is raised by Picasso's emblematic image, could be transposed in terms of a more fundamental formal problematic, one that lies at the very heart of the system of representation as such, and which Picasso himself had consummately explored almost half a century earlier in the papier collé or pasted paper collage. The problematic, namely, of the relation between the opposed pair of figure and ground and the ensuing multiplication of that opposition into the great stylistic markers like linear, painterly, planar, recessional, haptic, optic. These are sort of pairs of binary terms which in fact define what the system of representation is all about. It is the undecidability of that relation, the continual shuffling of the collage elements, whereby what reads as figure might also read as ground and vice versa, a differential play of signs that Rosalind Krauss has seen as a radical consequence of Picasso's pasted paper revolution, to borrow Clement Greenwood's designation of this invention from 1912 onwards. Now I want to show you just very rapidly examples of collage to just to sort of, you know, refresh your memories about what the kinds of sort of linguistic games involved in the sort of juxtaposition of printed matter in terms of sort of the juxtaposition of sort of how the same element can read as ground and as figure. Cubist collage is probably the first sort of intellectual or conceptual system of representation which is lends itself to a kind of structuralist or semiotic analysis, and that's really the point being made by Rosalind Krauss's reading of collage. I quote, "A reserve area of blank page is now figure, the guitar's frontal face." Here, for example, I don't know how this works. Voila. now ground, the surface against which a strip of wood grain paper rests. A newspaper shape is now read as atmospheric surround, that is optic, now as an object sharply cut edge, that is haptic or tactile. The great lesson of collage was therefore not only that meaning is produced from within a system of oppositions, but that those oppositions are structural in kind, that they are not the product of a theme or a given bit of content, but are instead the producers of such content, and can thus become the theme of a vast array of material, unquote. So the argument over here is that cubist collage is not about, let's say, a still life placed on a table, you know, a guitar or a pipe or a bottle. It's more to do with how those objects are reconfigured in terms of semiotic signs. The semiotic, specifically Saussurean reading of papier-collé, proposed by Krauss, sets itself in opposition to the interpretations that, in the eyes of the structuralists, seem to err on the side of reality, as it were. Whether it is the semantic decoding of the typography of cubism undertaken by Robert Rosenblum in his deciphering of the proper names that recur in the form of word fragments on the collage surface, or the detection of Picasso's political leanings from a reading of the content of the events in the newspaper snippets chosen by him as a collage element proposed by Patricia Layton. So, in other words, I mean, there are scholars who have actually painstakingly read and sort of traced, let's say, these fragments of newspapers, and very often, of course, they refer to contemporary events of the time, and have then interpreted, you know, the collage in question in terms of, let's say, the political content of those articles, that the snippets that Picasso used, etc. So, in a sense, this is a kind of reading which is actually, you know, taking literally the collage element and what it says as some kind of proof of what they mean. Finally, the divergence between the structuralist and their opposite number could be glossed as one between two opposed ways of apprehending the meanings of that continual equivocation between representation and reality, instanced by cubism itself. I just want to go through very quickly a range of collage images. You see, that's the kind of sort of material, let's say, which would, you know, the fragment over here would then, one could then read this collage as referring, among other, not just to a bottle on a table, but also related to the specific context at the time. That's one possible reading. The Cubist revolution that took place between 1908 and 1914 is what enables the 20th century to measure up to the achievements of the Renaissance. It was born of the unique collaboration between two artists of very different temperaments, and while the unraveling of the specific contribution of each artist has preoccupied several generations of art historians, it is now generally agreed that notwithstanding Park's chronological priority at certain key moments in the evolution of the style, I'll find you a bra in a minute. Voilà. Oops, sorry. I was looking at that landscape with my park, which is jumped off. It's okay, come, you can stay there if you like. Tap down, yeah. Yes. Okay. Shall I go back to what I was saying, that apropos of Cubism, that it was born of the unique collaboration between two artists of very different temperaments, and while the unraveling of the specific contribution of each artist has preoccupied several generations of art historians, it is now generally agreed that, notwithstanding Braque's chronological priority at certain key moments in the evolution of the style, including the crucial inflection given it by the example of Cézanne in the landscapes painted by Braque in 1908, it is Picasso's Cubism that offers the most formally exhaustive exploration of its potential. And this is one image by Braque, just to give you an idea, but I wanted to also show you images by Picasso, which are sort of precursors to the full-blown Cubist style. The fragmented representation of the world that Cubism instanced, altering thereby the very modalities of perception and of visuality itself, brought home in a hitherto unknown way the complexity of the act of seeing. That's also upside down, voila. I just saw a series of extraordinary Cubist portraits by Picasso while I read what I want to say here. The fragmented representation of the world that Cubism instanced, altering thereby the very modalities of perception and of visuality itself, brought home in a hitherto unknown way the complexity of the act of seeing. That locally, nominally, the world in question, contracted to the studios in which these pictures were painted, is the more telling in view of the repercussions that were to ensue. But the century was young then, as were Picasso and Braque. Cubism is the grey matter of modern art, and not only because of the austere monochromatism of its high analytical period. It is high modernism. This is another portrait, Cubist portrait by Picasso. It is high modernism, one of whose crucial components being the products and materials issuing from the lower depths of popular culture, both industrial and artisanal. It maintained a complex, irresolute tension between high and low, between oil painting and faux marbre, between Mallarmé's book and the tabloid. Cubism is an art of the sign. And I think the sign nature of Cubist collage, I think, would be evident by now. I'm not really, analyzing individual pictures, because the idea really is to sort of run through several images while I'm talking about a general point. Again, an extraordinary painting called Ma Jolie, Woman with a Guitar of 1911. And I come back to this extraordinary guitar. Just to clinch the point about when I say that this equivocation between high art and what is low, between popular culture and the tradition of oil painting, I think all that sort of crystallizes in Cubist collage and Cubist painting generally. Thank you. Cubism is an art of the sign in the larger sense of the word. It is, after all, a kind of sign language that Picasso intuited in the Gribeau mask in his possession, which you see here on the left, in the course of arriving at his Cubist construction guitar on the right, of 1912, another milestone in the history of art for the formal possibilities it inaugurates, notably in the way that its open, cutaway forms deal a blow to the tradition of the carved or modeled monolith that had been the bedrock of sculpture.
heykel sanatında kullanılan monolite bir karşıtlık olarak görülüyor.
That the impetus for such a formal breakthrough came from objects at the antipodes of the Western representational regime, and that, more generally, the aesthetic appropriation of tribal art by the European avant-garde for the punctual solutions it seemed to offer in the resolution of certain formal problems is, of course, part of the colonial unconscious of modernism that goes by the name of primitivism. I just show you one image here of Picasso in his studio with some of the tribal art which he then began to collect. This is a photograph of 1908. It seems appropriate, therefore, to punctually register this particular component of the high modernist enterprise, less the formal pyrotechnics for which the latter is justly celebrated, makes it impossible to pierce the ideological smokescreen that it leaves in its wake. What I'm saying really is that this purely formal appropriation of so-called primitive art does sort of tend to bracket avoid talking about the fact that that primitivism or the interest in primitive art is very much part of the colonial history of Europe. In practice, however, this general point needs to be nuanced according to the particular use to which the primitive is put. Here I'm just sort of juxtaposing, for example, a fang mask that Picasso saw and head on the right of 1908 to tell, I mean, just the kind of sort of very striking formal similarities between the two objects. Just as even Matisse at the same time was also obviously interested in primitive art, and you have a detail of Madame Matisse on your left, and which is juxtaposed with this extraordinary Shirakuna mask of painted wood which Matisse saw and incorporated in his pictorial language. Picasso's admiration for the tribal art to which he was exposed in the early part of the century, some of which he collected, is well known, and it could be argued that the otherness of the tribal retains its alterity as a destabilizing force, as sheer unassimilable incongruity within the Western representational apparatus, however mauled the later becomes as a result of the physicality of Picasso's grasp grappling with it. And I want to show you, of course, the great masterpiece of 20th century art, which is the Demoiselle d'Avignon of 1907. The exemplary case, of course, of the assimilation of tribal art is the pivotal painting of the 20th century, the Demoiselle d'Avignon of 1907, not least because the barbarian mask of the crouching figure on the right side of the picture, which is here, the barbarian mask of the crouching figure on the right side of the picture cannot be reduced to a particular example of African art, its primitivism as much a synecdoche of the tribal as such, as it is of the psychic violence that unfolds across the span of Picasso's brothel scene. The painting is the curtain raiser of Picasso's art, and in more ways than the unfurling gesture of the demoiselle in profile on the left-hand side. I mean her, of course. An explosive debut, in Leo Steinberg's phrase, whose formal repercussions Picasso will explore for the 6.5 decades to come. And since Steinberg's monograph lens study of the painting remains in the literature on the artist unsurpassed for its subtle formal analysis, its phenomenological acuity and descriptive eloquence, here is a more succinct account of the Demoiselle by him and of the reasons that make it the landmark it is in the history of modern art. I quote, "The picture crowds five disconnected figures, not as one group, nor in one ambiance, but each singly encapsulated. The lone curtain raiser at left, separated even from her own lifted hand by an unmediated space jump. The second figure stretched forth in reclining position, seen from on top. She arrives on the picture plane like a Murphy bed, hitting the wall. Obviously, this figure here. The straight middle figure adjacent, but with no spatial ties to her sister, seen from below again. Then those curtain folds like packed ice to quarantine the intruding savage at upper right,
which is here.
Treated in a menacing African mode, and lastly, crouched for enjoyment, an exotic jade, realized like no other, dorsal and frontal at once. And I think one would like to retain this in mind throughout the rest of the text, and what Leo Steinberg has to say about Picasso's desire to possess the object, the motif, from every possible direction, hence the idea of sort of seeing things from above, from below, etc. I continue with this quotation. Comparison with the numerous studies for the Demoiselle revealed, to show you various studies, how tenaciously Picasso pursued this end. He was resolved to undo he was resolved to undo the continuities of form and field. I'm just going through various preparatory stages for the figures, which clearly shows how much African art was important to Picasso. But here's the two sketches which are very important for in the genesis of the painting. He was resolved, I repeat, to undo the continuities of form and field which Western art had so long taken for granted. The famous stylistic rupture at right turned out to be merely a consummation. I want to go back to the painting. Overnight, the contrived coherences of representation art, the feigned unities of time and place, the stylistic consistencies, all were declared to be fictional. The Demoiselle confessed itself a picture conceived in duration and delivered in spasms. In this one work, Picasso discovered that the demands of discontinuity could be met on different levels, by abrupt changes of vantage point and by a sudden stylistic shift at the climax. Finally, the instant staccato of the presentation was found to intensify the picture's address and symbolic charge. Instead of observing a room full of lazing whores, he's targeted from all sides. So far from suppressing the subject, the mode of organization heightened its flagrant eroticism. The famous discontinuity principle that Steinberg has seen as being operative in different ways throughout Picasso's career is, in the Demoiselle, proclaimed with a boldness matched only by the brazenness with which the inmates of the philosophical brothel, as the painting came to be called by Picasso's intimates, stare down, indeed proposition the beholder. Continuous with an analysis that leaves no aspect of the work unturned is Steinberg's attentiveness to the modalities of beholding imposed by the pictorial configuration, specifically to the embodiedness of vision, the carnality of the beholder's gaze, as it encounters a space peculiar to Picasso's imagination. Not a visual continuum, but an interior apprehended on the model of touch and stretch, a nest known by intermittent palpation or by reaching and rolling. The erotics of Picasso's art, in almost all its phases, is the appeal to the sentience of the viewing subject in its confrontation with the artist's will to grasp, possess, exhaust every aspect of a motif in a given work. A voraciousness that is especially manifest, needless to say, when the motif in question is the object of desire. The discontinuities in the Demoiselle, the audacious co-presence of the tribal and the occidental, forecast a more generalized stylistic cannibalism, with the notable exception of the Cubist interlude, for, as one of the inventors of the style, the need to appropriate or outdo other styles was not, at the time, a pressing concern for Picasso. The predatory embrace of other idioms, past and present, reasserts itself once the moment of Cubism had passed, when the dynamic fueling the Cubist adventure was cut short by the outbreak of the First World War in 1914. But already, just 2 years prior to that debacle, still within the heyday of Cubism, the invention of collage inaugurates a radically juxtapositional mode of apprehending the world that, in the post-war years, will become part of a much general stylistic promiscuity as such. I want to show you this, another masterpiece of Cubist still life. This is still life in chair caning with its trompe l'oeil of the cane, chair caning, among other things. Thus, the juxtaposition of a section of oil painting, a Cubist still life, with a piece of commercially printed oilcloth that is itself a trompe-l'oeil image of artisanally fabricated chair caning in the first Cubist collage, the still life with chair caning of 1912, exemplifies the heterogeneity of material and medium, of the vernacular and the Mandarin that will increasingly become a signature trait of Picasso's oeuvre. The heterogeneity, the very basis of the collage principle, acquires emblematic status in a large and intriguing painting called Studies of 1920-1922, one of the very emblematic images in Picasso's career, Studies 1920-1922. With this combination of Cubist and Realist modes, a combination that has the strategic function, as Michael Fitzgerald has shown, of inscribing Picasso's modernist and traditional styles under the aegis of Renoir's classicizing late manner in the form of a quotation of one of Renoir's dancing couples. I just want to show you the dancing couple over here is alluding to, a motif which Renoir treated very often. The painting is also instructive of the way in which Picasso positions himself in relation to the immediate past, the more to assert his mastery in the present, and of the parallel this assertion of agency offers with another work by Matisse, Picasso's most illustrious contemporary. Thus, in Studies, the representation amidst Cubist still lives and the Renoir quotations of two hands, now you can see them here, they're very visible, foregrounded. The representation of two hands, the sheer fleshiness of whose modeling, constituting them as a very sign of health, offers a flagrant contrast with a drawing that Picasso made of Renoir in 1919, the year of Renoir's death, that delineates with a painful exactitude the aged painter's crippled hands. I'm afraid I don't have a slide of that drawing, but it's a very sort of very simple line drawing by Picasso, which focuses on Renoir's withered hand. So what I want you to have in mind is that this painting, which is quoting Renoir's dancing couple, for example, is also, in terms of the motif of the hand, referring, you know, by its very health and sentience, is obviously offers a contrast to Renoir's withered, arthritic hand. It is surely remarkable that at a crucial moment in his career, this attempt by Picasso to secure a place for the diversity of styles at his command within a larger classical tradition should be anchored formally, thematically, and psychically by the motif of the hand. Well, so you can get a glimpse of another Renoir dancing couple. An equally pointed contrast is offered between Matisse's remarks, and I'm showing you a self-portrait of Matisse over here, Matisse's remarks on the atrophied condition of Renoir's hands, occasioned by his first encounter with Renoir in the winter of 1917, and the large self-portrait by Matisse, begun the following day and completed in 1918, where the confident and assertive image that the latter has fashioned of himself is further accentuated by the robust rendering of the hands, in particular in the way in which his potency, I want to just keep in mind this detail here of the thumb, which is aligned to this brush, in particular in the way in which, I quote, his potency as man and artist is suggested by Jacques Flam, not only by a huge thumb that pokes its way out of the hole of his palette, but also by a brush alongside that juts directly towards the easel in more or less a phallic position. It would seem as if the example of the achievement of the Raphael without hands, this is the celebrated German art historian Meyer Graef's description of Renoir in the latter's last years, Raphael without hands, it would seem as if for Picasso as well as Matisse, at a crucial turning point in the careers of both, emblematized precisely by a homage to the hand, the very decrepitude of the biographical Renoir's mythic form-bestowing organ, the energizing source of its hypertrophied presence in the work of the two younger artists. What I'm also saying, in other words, is that the trope or the metaphor or the image of the hand is taken up by Picasso and by Matisse at crucial moments in their careers as a kind of enabling device, as a way of assertion of mastery, because of course painting, hand, etc. go together. Now, because I'm talking about Matisse, I just want to say a few remarks about Matisse, because of course Matisse was the only painter that Picasso esteemed, and the productive rivalry between the two greatest painters of the 20th century punctuates the careers of both at regular intervals until 1954, the year of Matisse's death. As Picasso remarked at the time, when Matisse died, he left his odalisques to me as a legacy. Unquote. Picasso's foray into nominal Orientalist territory, I just want to sort of show you a few images by what Picasso means, the kind of homage which Picasso pays to Matisse just after Matisse dies. For example, you have here seated nude with in a Turkish bonnet, that's the title of the work, which is obviously referring to the whole Orientalist theme in Matisse's work. This is work from 1955. Or again, nude in a rocking chair, which again is very Matissean in spirit and tone. And through these images, Picasso is obviously thinking about the kinds of sort of Orientalist images that Matisse painted in the 20s, notably the whole series of odalisques, which I'll show you in a minute. Voila, the kind of sort of, very rapidly, the kind of sort of Orientalist fantasy entertained by Matisse during the 1920s, which is why this sort of remark by Picasso, when Matisse died, he left his odalisques to me as a legacy. I'll just go through these images rapidly, just to give you an idea about the kind of sort of fantasized Orient in Matisse's work during this period in the 1920s. Picasso's revisiting of styles from the past during the period 1916 to 1924 within the larger context as what has come to be known in Jean Cocteau's phrase as the return to order, to the so-called timeless values of classicism, remains a vexed topic in the literature on the artist and on the early 20s as a whole, not least because the return in question heralded a new conservatism conservatism, sorry, in art and politics. I'm showing you sort of the kind of neoclassical works that Picasso resorted to in this period, which are obviously quoting or referring to Ang, to Renoir, and to a certain classicizing model, very French in tone and in its sort of desire to treat classical themes like the source over here, for example. While the negative assessment of Picasso's recourse to tradition, to Poussin, to Ang, to Corot, to late Renoir, follows from the striking contrast this latter offers with the radically innovative style that is Cubism. More broadly, it is the opprobrium which a certain view of modernism attaches to pastiche as such that has fed the censoriousness of critics hostile to Picasso's neoclassical manner. In this perspective, the great subject of the post-Cubist Picasso now becomes the very absence of or engagement with subjects equal to his technical facility. An opinion elaborated at length by John Berger in his book, The Success and Failure of Picasso, but whose germ is already contained in the reservations voiced by T.W. Adorno in 1963 about Picasso's recourse to revision consequent upon, I quote, the loss of collective energies that have produced the great innovations in European art, unquote. And I'm just going through again the kinds of sort of classicizing images of Picasso's neoclassical period. The most recent version of this view of Cubism's unrealized potential or unfinished project, to borrow Jürgen Habermas's majestic phrase to characterize modernity itself, is T.J. Clark's impassioned elegy for the waning of the utopian impulse that was the broken promise of modernism when he sees Cubism as fleetingly holding out the idea of a collectivity, even if it was a collectivity of two artists, that is Picasso and Braque. I quote from Picasso, at that time, our work was a kind of laboratory research from which every pretension or individual vanity was excluded, Picasso was to remark in retrospect. People didn't understand very well at the time why very often we, that is Picasso referring to Braque himself, didn't sign our canvases. It was because we felt the temptation, the hope of an anonymous art, not in its expression, but in its point of departure. We were trying to set up a new order, and it had to express itself through different individuals. Nobody needed to know what it was so-and-so that had done this or that painting. But individualism was already too strong, and that resulted in a failure. As soon as we saw that the collective adventure was a lost cause, each one of us had to find an individual adventure. And the individual adventure always goes back to the one which is the archetype of our times, that is, Van Gogh's An Essentially Solitary and Tragic Adventure, unquote. And I'd like you to keep Van Gogh in mind because I will, at the very end of his life, Picasso does go back to Van Gogh as a kind of model, as a kind of inspiration. The comradeship with Braque, which the Great War brought to an end, was replaced, as it were, by another kind of company that Picasso now came to keep. This was the fellow traveling with artists of the immediate and distant past, with Ang preeminent among them. And of course, I think the Angres model is very evident in all these sort of rather heavy, monumental, classicizing figures that I've just shown you. The incongruous cohabitation of the Cubist Picasso with a new classical Picasso in these years is symptomatic of the equivocations operative in modernism itself, inasmuch as the accommodation of contrary idioms can be seen either as an ironic stance towards style as such, or, on the contrary, as Rosenkrauss has recently argued, Picasso's pastiche of Angresque linearity has to be viewed as a defensive mimicry aimed at warding off the threat of a mechanistic paradigm for art practice under the aegis of photography and the ready-made, which was then in the ascendant, and as examples of the kind of menace which Picasso's recourse to new classicism was a defense, I'd like to show you a few works by Francis Picabia, you know, the Dada artist who was closely allied to Marcel Duchamp, to suggest the kind of sort of the ready-made paradigm, the model of the ready-made, which obviously is the antithesis of individual drawing, kind of the whole stance which Picasso stands for. So here we have, for example, a portrait of a young American girl in a state of nudity of 1915 by Picabia, and another work by Picabia again, portrait of Max Jacob, of 1915, to suggest that from a very different sort of direction of modern art, you have someone like Duchamp, Picabia, and the Dadaists in general, who are obviously subverting or the whole idea about art, who are sort of introducing the kind of sort of mechanistic paradigm for art through photography, among other things, and through the ready-made. Another Picabia. And here again, I bring you back to Picasso, an extraordinary drawing of portrait of Vollard of 1915, to suggest, as Rosenkraus seems to propose, that Picasso's recourse to a kind of sort of traditional draftsmanship in this kind of drawing is a kind of sort of a defense tactic to ward off the kind of invasion of photography and the ready-made, as represented by Duchamp and Picabia. So Picasso's appropriation of Ang's line, as in this drawing, would then, in this view, be a way of holding on to the métier of high art in the face of the de-skilling of traditional techniques that is augured, on the one hand, by the accelerating pervasion of reality by the mechanical means of reproduction, that is photography, and on the other, by the increasingly automated nature of pictorial abstraction itself. I quote Rosalind Krauss, "If the photographic image is notoriously a function of multiple prints spun out from a single negative, the structures arrived at by abstract painters," and I'm showing you several images by Robert Delaunay of 1915, to suggest that this kind of abstraction is also potentially undertaken when it's undertaken in series, is potentially also obeying a kind of mechanistic paradigm. I go back to my quotation, that if the photographic image is notoriously a function of multiple prints spun out from a single negative, the structures arrived at by the abstract painters, the grids, the nested squares, the monochromes, the color fields, are themselves submitted to the mark of the multiple. For the matrix within which any given abstract idea is consummated has been the extended, repetitive production of the series. Delaunay. The logic of abstraction, no less than of photography, is then a fight against the unique, the original, the non-replicable. And of course, Picasso is very much the artist who insists on the original, the unique, and the non-replicable. It could be argued, however, that the positing of pastiche I'm going back to Picasso's neoclassical manner. Here's an extraordinary painting called The Flutes of Pan, and it dates from 1921. It could be argued, however, that the positing of pastiche as a panic reaction on the part of Picasso to the impending devaluation of traditional mimetic skills is overdetermined by the valorization of a discourse of the duplicate, the copy, the multiple, the secondhand, that has now become the contemporary critical touchstone, if not the consensus, of a postmodernism radically skeptical of the notion of originality that was one of modernism's working illusions. If Picasso's neoclassicism, which is after all but an episode in a career spanning more than six decades, has now come in for an extended critique, it is perhaps in part in reaction to the complacent generalization of pastiche as a leading trope of postmodernism, taking the term in Frederick Jameson's sense of the cultural logic of late capitalism. The most important critical reflection on pastiche prior to Jameson, to the time when postmodernism was not yet the cultural dominant it has now become, is of course Adorno's famous attack on Stravinsky's neoclassical masquerades. And it is these strictures that have set the general terms for all subsequent critiques of pastiche as a mode whenever artists have resorted to it in the modern era. So what I'm saying is really that these kinds of works are obviously on one level a homage to a certain classical canon, but they're also in their own ways a pastiche of that canon of classicism. And the whole vexed question about how to interpret pastiche is precisely what has engaged various historians over the last couple of years. The larger theoretical context for these aesthetic judgments is the extraordinary debate concerning the dialectical opposites of realism and modernism between Ernest Bloch, Georges Lukács, Bertolt Brecht, Walter Benjamin, and Adorno, that was underway from the 1930s onwards. For our purposes here, let us simply note Susan Sontag's succinct remarks made in 1965 on the uneven development, not to say the changing fortunes, of such terms as reaction and progress, as these were applied to some of the most important artists of the era. I quote, "True, Schoenberg is defended by Adorno in his philosophy of modern music, but in the name of progress. Adorno complements his defense of Schoenberg with an attack on Stravinsky, whom he unfairly identifies with just one period, the neoclassical. For raving the past, for making musical pastiches, an analogous case could be made against Picasso. Stravinsky is labeled as a reactionary, in the end, a fascist. However, Kafka is attacked by Lukács for the qualities which, mutatis mutandis in the history of music, would have made him, in Adorno's term, a progressive. Kafka is a reactionary because of the allegorical, that is, the dehistoricized texture of his writings, while Thomas Mann is a progressive because of his realism, that is, his sense of history. In the one case, reaction is identified with an inauthentic relation to the past, in the other, with abstractness," unquote. The hindsight that allows one to relativize the contesting claims of a now historical controversy proves to be not less useful in delineating the broader affinities of temperament and sensibility that Picasso can be seen to have shared with some of his peers. "The great cultural heroes of our time," writes Sontag in her superb essay on Godard, "have shared two qualities. They have all been ascetics in some exemplary way, and also great destroyers. But this common profile has permitted two different, yet equally compelling attitudes towards culture itself. Some, like Duchamp, Wittgenstein, and Cage, bracket their art and thought with a disdainful attitude towards high culture and the past, or at least maintain an ironic posture of ignorance or incomprehension. Others, like Joyce, Picasso, Stravinsky, and Godard, exhibit a hypertrophy of appetite for culture, the more often avid for cultural debris than for museum-consecrated achievements. They proceed by voraciously scavenging in culture, proclaiming that nothing is alien to their art," unquote. Picasso did turn to Picasso did turn to museum-consecrated achievements in the penultimate decade of his life, that is between 1953 and 1963, with a disarming directness that comes with old age and after a lifetime spent in the company of the masters who had come to inhabit his personal pantheon. And here I show you one among the innumerable variations on Velázquez's Las Meninas, proposed by Picasso, and of course the original is here. Voila. And I'll go back to Picasso's version of it. This was a revisiting of the past, staged as an encounter with his private demons, a seemingly endless round of theme and variations, fueled by an impatience and usurpatory elan, that couldn't have been more removed from the neoclassical pirouettes of the early 20s. The objects of admiration, Velázquez's Las Meninas, Delacroix's Women of Algiers, Manet's Déjeuner sur l'herbe, Luncheon in the Grass, among other masterpieces, were at the same time the adversarial subjects that needed to be confronted and reckoned with one last time, seized upon in all their aspects in accordance with the famous discontinuity principle, the staging of ubiquitous vision, the desire to simultaneously possess back and front. I'm just showing various variations on Las Meninas by Picasso, which also illustrate perfectly the play of the discontinuity principle, which is the staging of ubiquitous vision, the desire to simultaneously possess back and front, to make profilation coincident with frontality, that have been extensively analyzed by Leo Steinberg. And I want to just go through very quickly the variations around other. Some of the other modern masters. This is again, we're still with Las Meninas. You can see the element of homage, but also of caricature, of the grotesque, which is very much part of Picasso's sensibility. These are ways of sort of, you know, positioning himself in terms of the achievements of the past and then trying to outdo the old master, to, you know, and this sort of rivalry with other painters has been a productive, constructive rivalry, is very much part of Picasso's art. This is again, you know, a shorthand way of showing you Las Meninas here. If I can, voila. And then, of course, the other variations around it. Then there are, of course, the variations after Delacroix's the Women of Algiers. Here is the, therefore, this is an excellent sort of also example of what Leo Steinberg proposes as a discontinuity principle, about how Picasso's desire to possess, you know, the object, the subject, the motif, the body, makes him sort of contort shapes and forms, and how the desire to possess is sort of, you know, is viewed frontally, but also from the back, from in, it's multi-directional really, which is unique to Picasso's style. This is, of course, the original Delacroix's masterpiece. And I'll show you very quickly some of the variations, the very insolent and humoristic variations on the Women of Algiers. And of course, the other great masterpiece from Picasso appropriates, so to speak, is The Luncheon in the Grass, Déjeuner sur l'herbe of Manet. Again, very quickly, there's the original. And of course, Picasso's variations on him. And again, another page which sort of juxtaposes the various drawings which fed into the variations on Manet's painting. At the very end of his life, this instinct to possess would aspire to become literally so in those valedictory visualizations of undiminished ardor, of unbridled lust, which bring Picasso's corpus to a close. And I'm just going to run through the late Picasso images of nudes and people embracing, which until very recently weren't really taken seriously by a lot of people, but have now proved to be, you know, the kind of, sort of apotheosis of Picasso's art, in part because of the kind of urgency, psychic, but also pictorial urgency that they translate, how Picasso evolved a kind of sign language to delineate the body. And of course, they are extremely they come out of someone who knows that he's sort of reaching some kind of end. Various images, as I said, which of late Picasso, they all sort of date from the late 60s onwards. This is lying nude of 67. Couple of 67, and the whole among the other themes which recur in these works is, of course, the desire to abolish all distance between the subject and the object, to sort of it's a kind of possession of the model in pictorial and not only pictorial but not only pictorial metaphors. The discontinuity principle that is taken to an incandescent extreme in Picasso's late homage to and appropriation of certain canonical paintings of the past manifests itself, as Steinbeck has shown, in different forms throughout all phases of his career. And I want to keep going, letting this to a close. It's an extraordinary embrace of 1970. It could be also argued that the principle of disjunction or discontinuity enacts, in terms of the representational means deployed within a particular work, the collage instinct would appear to dictate as an attitude towards representation as such. What I'm saying is that the extraordinary invention of collage confirms in a way what is operative throughout Picasso's career, before and after that invention, which is to say, the accommodations of different kinds of worlds, different kinds of styles, different kinds of motifs, their collision on the picture surface, which is very unique to Picasso, and which, and one way of describing that would be by this discontinuity principle, by disjunction. Moreover, the formal heterogeneity that is the basis of collage could also reveal itself to be capable of unpredictable iconographic swerves, as in the particularly entitled Minotaur of 1928, a work the more surprising given the very first appearance of this mythic creature in Picasso's oeuvre in a medium that he had until now deployed in exploring a nominally mundane object world. Minotaur was also the name suggested by Georges Bataille of the famous surrealist magazine, the cover of whose first issue Picasso designed in 1933. The metamorphic quality of Picasso's oeuvre was evidently amenable to surrealist taste, as was the eroticism of his treatment of the female form. Metamorphosis was second nature to Picasso, a distinctive feature of his work that long predated his association with surrealism and will remain so after he'd outlived the movement. And I want to show you another extraordinary work by Picasso. These are again works of the late 70s, late 60s, of couples embracing. But I want to come now to this extraordinary bull's head of 1942. And metamorphosis, I repeat, was second nature to Picasso, a distinctive feature of his work that long predated his association with surrealism and remained so after he'd outlived the movement. The extraordinary bull's head of 1942, made of a bicycle seat and handlebar, could alone stand as the very icon of Picassoian metamorphosis, even as it could be read on another level as a brilliant riposte to the Duchampian ready-made. And I wanted to show you Duchamp's bicycle wheel in passing. Meanwhile, the Minotaur would henceforth be a frequent talismanic presence in his art, accompanying him in the meander of the stylistic loops and turns which describe the labyrinth that is Picasso's oeuvre. The present talk, however, signposts only those corners of the maze explored by some of the more recent, and not so recent, but certainly compelling scholarship on this most protean of modern artists. And I want to end really by showing you this very late image of Picasso, an extraordinary painting which is from 1971, and it's called simply Seated Old Man. And it goes back to what I said earlier on about the whole idea of avatar or metamorphosis, in the sense that this the image sort of condenses various references. It's a kind of sort of late leave-taking of some of the masters most admired by Picasso, which he incorporates into his own image, because obviously this is a self-portrait. What he has done here is he's quoting Van Gogh's portrait of Dr. Gachet, which with a straw hat, which you can see here. He's also quoting Cézanne's portrait of his gardener Vallier. Plus, he's also quoting this extraordinary painting by Matisse called Romanian Blouse, with these decorative motifs which occur in the Matisse, which he's now putting here as well. But the most, perhaps the most telling and poignant detail is obviously this detail of, if I can get there. Of this, sorry. Which is really a withered hand, which is obviously alluding to you know, to his encounter with Renoir's art and to that drawing which is made of Renoir in 1917. And here we are in 1971, where Picasso is actually, in a way, taking leave of the world by, in fact, condensing various, you know, homages to some of his most revered icons. And I'd like to sort of think that the whole idea of metamorphosis in some ways complete or turns full circle with a painting like Old Man, Seated Old Man of 1971. Thank you.